मॉर्निंग एवरीवन. ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ ओरो यूनिवर्सिटी स्कूल ऑफ आईटी आई एक्सटेंड टू यू ऑल अ वेरी वार्म एंड हार्टी वेलकम. टुडे वी हैव विद अस मिस्टर ध्रुवेश कलातिया हु इज एन एलुमनाई फ्रॉम बैच 2015-18. ही हैज स्टडीड डेटा साइंस एज अ स्पेशलाइजेशन and now placed in Blue Conch as a developer for machine learning and deep learning. We are very proud to introduce him as a speaker for the webinar. Dhruvesh, over to you.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you, ma'am. So hello, everyone. My name is Dhruvesh, and if I talk about my experience, a few years back, I was there at your side and right now, means today I am here in front of you guys talking about what I am doing, what I have learned in these few years in Oro, and after that in other university, and then in as an intern in this company. So I want to share you about what data science is. So I'm working in machine learning field, which is a part of data science. And so here I am right now, here I am in front of you explaining this field to you guys, so that you, I can inspire you, so that you in future or even as an in future, you guys can join me, or so that I'm here to inspire you. So let us start with the PPT. So I'm sure you can see my screen.
Yes, we can see.
So now I'm placed in Blue Conch Technology right now. And let us start with giving you introduction about data science. So what is data science? So here is a definition from online, but I know that you might or might not get it. I'll explain you. So it is not much hard. If you even break these two words, data and science, individually, and understand both words perfectly, then you can understand what is the agenda of this field, what we do as a data scientist. So let's start with data. So I hope every one of you have learned about data, means what is data in schools, because in even 11th, 12th, and even 10th, we in computer subject we had this definition that what is data and how the flow goes to data from to information from knowledge. So data is a fact. So whatever I'm speaking right now is also a data. Whatever who you are seeing on your screen, that definition and everything, all, and not only that, but images on all the images on Instagram, Facebook, all the posts, all the Twitter posts, all of them is a data. And let's understand now what science is, then I'll tell you what is the motto of us, what motto of being a data scientist. So science, if you just Google it online, then you'll find the simplest definition of science as an knowledge about or a study of a natural world based on facts through experiments and observations. So if you correlate, means if you just swap the words natural world to data, then it will be like a knowledge about and study or a study of data based on facts, which is based on facts through experiment. Here it's not an experiment, it's an experience, past data, and all the we can say algorithms that we apply on it. So that experience and observation. So so what is the agenda of it? So the main main goal for understanding the data is to use that knowledge, the information that we have learned, to use it in organization or in this real world, and make some changes, make some effect onto organization or a social and our environment or a social life. So the idea is to use the past data, understand it, and use it for making some prediction, or using this knowledge to make some impact in the society. So the next this is what data science is, and now we'll understand why data science. So before that, I just want to make you aware. So this is a saying that I've just copied from somewhere online. So it says that the ability of taking data, understanding it, processing it, extracting value out of it, visualizing it, and communicating. So right now you must have think that how can we communicate with data? So you will understand eventually, because it's just a querying data or a fetching out some information, asking the question to a data, and it will in a query form, and it will give you some result. So this is what communication means here. So using all these is going to be an important skill in next decade, because we know that how much data is being generated every day. So let us go to our next topic, which is why data science. But there is some example I want to show you why data science, on the why data science. So we know that assume that there is a small shopkeeper. So he is owning a general store. So he must have aware about all the things that he has in he has in stock in his store. And all that, not only that, but which product is being sold more, which customers buys more, which product, and how much stock is there, and what is the difference, differentiate between the sales of different product, different products, same product from different vendors. For example, Maggi and Yippee. Both the companies make noodles, but which product is more famous? Which product is intended to buy more? Which customer buys which product? So all these information and all this knowledge, he must have known all of these, because it's a small shop. He owns a small shop, but what if he owns a mall like Big Bazaar? Then it is very hard for him to understand which product is being sold more, and what customer intend to buy what product. So all these quotient, we can say a quotient, like a quotient or analysis, is very hard for a person who runs a mall. And for that we have created systems like BI tools, which helps them to understand their organization, their sales, and their working of the whole organization. So this is why we use data science. And even there are some more. So here in this slide, you can imagine, you can see that first reason is to unstructured and semi-structured data. So right now, so we must have known that even for the elections. So for last Indian election for Prime Minister, so I read one article in newspaper that they are using data scientists, means they are hiring data scientists to know that who will win in the next election based on the Twitter, all the Twitter and Facebook posts. So how they are doing it? So we know that on Facebook and Twitter, all the data is unstructured. It's like it's maybe an image or a text, some text. So based on analyzing all that data, they just try to know that what type of people knows wants what type of what people wants from the Prime Minister or a next Prime Minister, and based on that they create a speech or then give a speech, and then they eventually wins the election. So BI tools that are not capable of processing this much use this huge volume. So we know that first traditional systems are only made for structured data. There are so many they were created, I mean all these MySQL and Oracle, they've created BI tools also, but they are mostly for structured data. Now even they are also going changing their tools for and making it capable for unstructured and semi-structured. But in between there the some of the company came out and they became a main source of supply for these BI tools. So then comes next complex structure of the data and different data formats. So if we take the same example of election, they must have got the data from Facebook, from like Instagram, from somewhere like Twitter, so and even LinkedIn. So these all are the different different platforms. They have different data. They must have different for data formats for their posts and their organization. But getting the data from all of them and creating a system that works like that takes all that data and based on the it formats the data and then makes it a single point where means in a converts into a single format, which is hard. So this is why the data science came into picture. And this was all for why data science. Now we'll talk about jobs and expertise, areas of expertise. These next two slides goes parallel end to end. So there are mainly three types of jobs. If you see a position, there may be more than one positions, but the type of jobs is divided into only these three. So data engineering, data engineers, data analysts, and data scientists. So what does data engineer do? So the job of data engineer is to prepare data and have expertise in building an infrastructure that integrates the data from different sources and various sources. So if we go to the next slide, so these are the areas of expertise, and the data engineer's job mostly falls into data engineering, data mining, cloud computing, and data management systems. So and they mostly use data. They should have expertise in data architecture, SQL and other database solutions, ETL tools, Hadoop based systems like HBase, Hive, MapReduce, HDFS. They must have knowledge of all these. Whereas data analyst, the job of data analyst is to analyze the data and understanding the organization and understanding the use case, or we can say understanding the problems of organization, and based on the data come out with the solution. So a data analyst must have knowledge of mathematical and statistical abilities. They must have they must have good understanding of statistics and the economical part of the part of the education, I mean the expertise. Then he must have as for a technical, he must know the SQL queries, SQL or other databases, based on what database the company organization is using. Because more all the organization, not all the organization is using same database. Some is using SQL, some is MongoDB, some uses Cassandra, and so and some uses Oracle as in service. So the data. Concept, basic concept is the same, but the queries are different, or the approach of approach for operations is different. So they must have knowledge about that. Then Python language, then R and BI tools like Tableau and Power BI. And the domain expert, he should have analytical skills, he should know how to analyze the huge data, how to manage, how to work with huge data, huge amount of data, and some knowledge of machine learning. Not that he must know how it is working, but he should know that what are the machine learning models are there, algorithms are there, and all. So here, if you talk about expertise, area of expertise, business intelligence, data visualization, domain expertise, and data management. As per domain, means why domain expertise? Means for example, I'm working in health organization, so I must have knowledge about all the health related problems and the data which I saw, like in the data of the health organization, the features, not features, but we can say the parameters will be different than the company who is doing e-commerce. So I must have domain expertise in that area. So let us go with the big data technologies. I'm just going to give overview of big data technologies and cloud computing, why it is being used, because our main goal here is to understand machine learning and all the things related to it. So big data technologies. So big data, before understanding big data technology, you must understand what big data is. So the basic concept that defines the big data is three V's. So
hello, Dhruvesh. Dhruvesh, are you there?
Hello.
Yes, Dhruvesh, we can hear you. You may continue.
Yeah, sorry, because of power cut.
Not an issue. You may continue.
Yeah. Where was I? I didn't know exactly. Hello.
Area of expertise.
Okay, areas of expertise. So here, areas of I must have told you about data engineer job, data analyst, and data scientist job. So in data engineer's job, it is preparing the data and building the infrastructure for integrating the data and from the different resources. The expertise falls into data engineering, data mining, cloud computing, and data management. Data analyst jobs is to find out the important patterns or the information and knowledge out of the data, and analyzing the data. So he must have worked with huge data. He must have expertise, means he must have worked with huge amount of data and have statistical and mathematical abilities, and must have known about statistical inferences and all the statistical formulas, so for analyzing the data. And he should also be aware about BI tools like Tableau and Power BI. And the last is data scientist. He actually creates the model for the future prediction. So he must have. So data scientist and data analyst has not much difference between them. Data scientist job is to, he understands all the algorithm from by heart. He knows everything, how it works and everything, whereas data analyst just knows about that there is machine learning and these are the models. He doesn't know how it works perfectly, and it is okay for them. But data scientist must know how it is work, how the calculation is being underneath the data algorithms, and he must have aware about Python, R. And he must have also the expert means some knowledge about databases, better understanding of models and analytical skills also. And he, main part is he should know the data modification very well. So because there are different types of data is coming from the different sources. So he must have known to how to manage all these data. And the data expertise area of expertise is machine learning, deep learning, natural language processing, and somewhat in a domain expertise. If he works in a special in a particular domain. So in big data technologies, I'm just going to give overview of it. So in big data technologies, so we should know about what big data is first of all. So in big data, to define big data, we first know about the rule of three V's. So here three V's are volume, velocity, and variety. So by volume, it means that the volume of data is so much huge. And as we know that even if we take an example, Instagram has 500 generates 500 TBs of data every day, 500 TBs of data every day, and 2.7 billion likes, and more than 300 million photos every day. So he must have known. So the system that they are using should very powerful, and the data scientist or the people who are working to manage all this data and using that data to find out the information and patterns out of it should have expertise. So the volume of data is huge, velocity, so the the volume, we have seen volume, but speed at the data which is coming is also too much fast. It means in as I talk that 500 TBs of data every day, and in every minute more than a billion user will probably using that Instagram and posting the photographs. So the data, it is the data at which speed it is coming is high, and the variety. So variety of data, it means here it means by the varieties the different types of data. We know that the Instagram we upload photographs as well as captions, then if not photogram then videos. So so we can understand that how the different types of data is there. Even text is there, video is there, even image is there. So this is it. So it that is why we use big data technologies, and in that the Hadoop system is very much used, and cloud computing is also is being used nowadays more. And if not Hadoop, then there is some alternative of it, like Gutenberg and other other competitors of it. So what type of expertise should that this person have? So he must have known Scala, Java, Python, these languages, along with that Hadoop. Means if it is Hadoop, then Hadoop technology, how it is working, MapReduce, the then Hive, HBase, Pig, Kafka, and understanding of all these, and how to code in these languages. So he must have known all these. And then if we talk about cloud computing, then as we know that in today's world, most of the companies using cloud storage. So all the data that we are using is on cloud, is on internet somewhere, and we are using that data. And not only that data, but as the data increases, the processing power that needs to process all that data is also increases. And for that, creating a environment in premises is a bit costly, because it requires the servers, maintenance, the space. Whereas the using the cloud computing, it just requires a account and the knowledge of using the cloud computing, cloud services, and the money that the money that you rent the infrastructure for. So in nowadays, most of the data scientists and most of the not data scientists but organization uses these cloud services. And even cloud services like Amazon Web Service, AWS, Azure, and Google is also right now giving the facilities of creating these machine learning models, training it on their services, so that it is very easy for a developer to use it directly. So next, I'm going to talk about why next I'm going to talk about machine learning. And in machine learning, we use Python and R mostly. But before going further, I just want to tell you that why Python and R, because there are so many languages like C, C++, Java, and even C and C++ are faster than other languages. Then why Python, not why not C and C++? So main intention of using Python and R, because it is open source, and there are because it is open source, then because it is open source, most of the developers create libraries and other tools in Python and R, and outsource their development and their product. So we can easily use those products without any, free of cost. We don't have to pay for these libraries, and it provides great functionality with mathematics, statistic, and scientific functions. And R is mostly created for statistical and scientific purpose. And even deep learning frameworks are available in Python, and the libraries like NumPy, Pandas, Matplotlib, SciPy. These are the libraries which is being mostly used in data science, and as a data scientist we mostly use it. So these are available in Python. So we use these libraries. Now let's come to the machine learning. But machine learning, some people also think that machine learning is something like AI, but it is not. So I just want to differentiate between machine learning and AI. So AI is what we see. What is AI, first of all? So most of us must have think that it's something that we saw in movie. So whatever we see in these movies is AI, but it's not true as of now, because there is no system that can work as well as those system that we see in movies. So AI is artificial intelligence. It is the way of making us. It is a way of creating a system that can think like us, or we can say a take judgment by its own, or take a decision by its own, and and perform some task. So AI is mostly algorithms and mathematical calculations, after all. And the machine learning is the one of the way of implementing the artificial intelligence. There are so many other algorithms are also there also, like BFS, breadth first search, BFS. There are so many algorithms. There are so many other ways of creating AI. But machine learning is one way that is being used mostly to create artificial intelligence, and the deep learning is a part of machine learning. So what is AI? So as I said, that it is a way of designing or building of intelligent agent which can take decisions by itself and receives a percept. Percept is here is input from the environment. It takes input from the environment and takes action based on the whatever input it has got. So, and the second, I have also put it two definitions because so that you understand it properly. So it is a branch of computer science that concerned with automation and intelligence behavior. So what actually AI? It is combination of complex algorithm and mathematical functions, which and first AI was created, artificial intelligence created in 1966. The name was Aliza, and it was asking the question like psychotherapist. It is psychotherapist. And it was not much of it was working on just regular expression, that whatever the sentence is being spoken by a user, it takes it using regular expression, it figure out the main word from the that sentence, and then based on that words, it used to ask some question. So it was a basic conversational AI which was first created in 1966. And there are two types of AIs, strong and weak. So as I told you that what we see in movie is strong AI, and whatever which is in existence right now is weak AI. So what is the difference? Weak AI is intended to for only a specific task. For example, a chess game AI, AI that plays chess game. So it has only expertise, means it can only play chess. It cannot play any other game. Or we can say a conversational AI like Alexa or OK Google. So they are only intended to give you the output based on whatever you say. And if the functionality is not added into its system, then it won't give you the answer. It will just say that we didn't understand your sentence. Please ask again. So these are the examples of weak AI. And what is the capabilities of AI? So generalized learning. So with this word, I mean that if I have trained the AI on one task, then it should able to perform the task which is similar. So if I trained my AI in some environment, then it should work fine for the environment which is similar. And the reasoning, like for example, if there is two path in ahead of the agent, that there is a one rocky road and there is a plain road, then it should take the decision that on which path he should follow. And the problem solving, which is like mathematical problems or any other scientific problems. So this is what AI is. And to implement it, we use algorithms and mathematical functions. And the machine learning is the way that we can implement AI. So there is one saying also by this is a professor at Stanford University, and he is the artificial intelligence scientist and doing research in AI. And he said that she often says to her students that don't to mislead with artificial intelligence, because it's nothing artificial about it. It's just a algorithm and can mathematical equation, and which is created by human to intend to behave like a human and ultimately impact the human life and human society. So next is what machine learning is. So this is the layman definition that you'll find on online. So machine learning is the science of getting computers to learn and act like human do, and improve their learnings over time and autonomous fashion by feeding them data and information in the form of observation and real world interaction. So it's simple words, it is a way of creating a system that learns from the data, and in future, if it has been given a similar kind of situation which is included in data, then it will automatically take the actions on it. It can give the output on it. So this is a scientific definition given by Tom Michel. So he wrote that a computer program is being said to learn from experience E. So if we go here, so even here it has written that by feeding them data and information and observation, which is past data, experience. And with respect to some class, task T. But why we are feeding the data to perform some task? So in with respect to task, this task, some task, and the performance measure P. And with respect to task, but as the task is being complete, means as the program performs the task, we also calculate the measure means performance. And if the performance at the task T, if the performance at that task, for that task, as measured by P, improves with the experience. And so as the time goes and as the repeats the same task again and again, and the performance of the performance of the machine, if it increases, then it is being called as machine learning. And here also it has been written same thing, feeding the past information and observation, and improves their learning over time in autonomous fashion, and getting computer to learn that task. So now we'll understand the what comes in machine learning. So even machine learning is divided into three major category, which is unsupervised, supervised, and in reinforcement learning. So we will discuss this in next few slides also. What is the intention of all each and everyone? And even supervised is divided into regression and classification, and unsupervised is divided into clustering and dimension reductionality. So before moving forward, I would like to tell you the machine learning life cycle. What means so how actually the system learns a particular task. So here we feed feed the raw input data, so which is the data that we have extracted from different sources. So we feed this data, we take this data, and then we try and pre-process the data. So what comes in pre-process? So it is transforming data, encoding data, that the machine can understand the data. Because as we know that, for example, let me take an example that you are trying to predict that if the student has earned this much of marks in these subjects, then whether he will get the admission in particular college or not. So in that there is a column named age also, column named age. So here age will be male and female, but does the computer understand the male and female? No. So for that we actually converts into a binary or a category, or like 0, 1, 2, 3. If there are more, there is a male, female, and other, then 0, 1, 2. Or if it is male and female, then we'll just encode it and encode it to 0 and 1. For example, 0 as in male and 1 as in female. And after pre-processing the data, we apply some exploratory data analysis, where we actually analyze the data for understanding the data, for figuring out what column in the data affects the output most. and we summarize the main characteristics using visualization. So here there are so many libraries, like you'll find like Matplotlib, Seaborn, which is only for which is being used for EDA, this exploratory data analysis. And here we understand the underlying trend or pattern and relationship between correlation or relation between the columns. After understanding the data, we why we understand the data first. So we know that how what output we need and what input we need, but we should understand that what input affects my output. Then only I'll be able to train the machine learning algorithm or my model perfectly without any minimum error, because I cannot no one can say that there will be no error in a machine learning model, but I with the minimum error. So I should be able to understand the data perfectly. So that's why we do exploratory data analysis. After that, we do feature engineering or feature extraction, where we actually because why we do that. So in examples, in some of the examples which you'll use for learning these algorithms, you will not find so much so many columns. But in actual, in real life, when you get the data, there are hundreds of columns are there, and which is affecting my output and which is not, we don't know that. So for that, we actually do using this exploratory data analysis, and there are some mathematical ways also in machine learning which I use, which we use and find out the correlation between the data. And after finding the correlation, we actually see that what column affects the most and what column does not affect at all. And if it is, it does not affecting my output, then I just remove that data, remove that column. And if it is affecting very low, then I can using feature extraction, I can actually set the how much importance to the input I should give. So this is why we use feature extraction. We do feature extraction, and then machine learning models, algorithms. So in machine learning algorithms, most of them are statistical and mathematical functions. And here the idea is to feed the data into that equations, or into that model, into that mathematical function. For example, we know that y is equals to mx plus c. So this is a simple linear function that we have learned in our schools. So we know that y is equals to mx plus c. Here we have x and y. So the input I am getting is x, and there will be a y also output what I want. And using those two, I actually calculate the value of m and c. In mx plus c, I actually calculate m the value for m and c. And after calculating that, I use those m and c value to predict for the next some other x, that what will be the value of y for some other x, which is not in the raw data. So our goal is to find this, fit these mathematical functions and find the correlations. So after finding the correlation, we select the model. Model selection part comes. So here we do model selection because not all the algorithms gives the same accuracy. Using different algorithm, you'll find different accuracy, you'll find different performance measures, and you only select those algorithm, one or two algorithm which gives the best accuracy. So we do some model selection. And here there's one more thing which is model parameter tuning, but I have not included it into this because it is just an overview. Because if I'll explain the model tuning, then it will be go far into the machine learning. But there is also model tuning which comes in model model selection part. So there we have the same model, but we tune we change some values into that model and try to run it again and check that whether it is the prediction output result is improving or not, the accuracy is improving or not. And if it is improving, that then we obviously choose that model as an final. So now we'll come to supervised, unsupervised and reinforcement learning. So this machine learning life cycle is mostly same for all three, not all three, but two of them, first and second. And reinforcement learning is some other thing which I'll explain when we come to that. So supervised learning, so our goal is to find a useful approximation of a function f of x that underlies predictive relationship between input and output. So in simple language, I am giving input x, I am telling the this should be the output, and then I train the model. And the model, after training the model, I try to predict for some new unknown data. So in the diagram also you can see that this is the pictures of apple, and we are also telling that these are apples, and we train the model. And after the training, model will automatically by itself will predict that given a photo of apple, that it is apple. And our goal is to do that. So algorithms are referred to as supervised because they learn making prediction given examples of input data, and our models are supervised and corrected. So it might happen that first time I give the input the pictures of apple and apple and mangoes, and I'm telling that this is the apple and the mango in front of. If it is a mango, this is a mango, and I'm training it. But sometimes it happens that I have given the apple image of apple, it predicts that it is mango. And to correct it, we use some algorithms, optimizing algorithms, which you'll learn if you go into deeper these. So we also there are also optimization algorithms who actually corrects the output. If it is predicting wrong, then we tune the parameters again and try to fit it in a right manner so that it can give the right answer to my question. So the next is so these are the supervised machine learning algorithms. So linear regression, logistic regression, which is the classification. Linear regression is a regression model, regression model. Support vector machine is a regression and classification model both. Naive Bayes is a classification model. Deep decision tree is the both regression and classification model. KNN is also both, and neural network is also classification and regression. So next is unsupervised learning. So in unsupervised learning, there is no instructor or no teacher. So in the supervised, I'm giving the image of apple and telling that it is an apple. But here I'm not telling that it is an apple. Instead, there are so many fruits are there, and based on the colors and the shape of the fruit, it automatically segregates the data. And unsupervised learning also it does the same. given a data, it tries to learn a pattern. It tries to differentiate two different records or two different input records. So if we take an example, then you must have known that bank segregates their customer based on their performance. If the EMI, then is a person paying EMI regularly or not, and there are many more factors which is being taken into observation. And after that, it segregates the customer, and for the customers who pays their EMIs regularly, they give some offers. Like you can take one, you can add up in your loan amount or something. So this is one use case. And second is phone company, based on user data and plan, segregates the user, and so that they can provide the users different offers and market their products. So in here, the hierarchical clustering, k-means, DB scan, optics algorithms, and mixture algorithm models are being used mostly. So now it comes to reinforcement learning. So in reinforcement learning, we don't have a past data. We might not have past data, but based on the calculation and based on the mathematical function, the agent takes the input from the environment, and based on mathematical function, it try to predict the output, try to calculate the output, and takes the action on it. And if the agent agent is right, then it is being rewarded. And if it is not, then the agent is being penalized. And this way, the agent actually learns. In every iteration, it learns and update their parameters, and increase the performance. So here, the examples are games. So we know that chess game and some other games, like even in if we see that Dota and CSGO and PUBG, these games has a bot in their system. Means if sometimes they can find the user in PUBG, if there's an 100 user limit. But if they cannot find the 100 user, then they add the bots, and the bots try use this reinforcement learning to learn how to play game. So these were three types of machine learning categories, and now we'll talk about applications of machine learning. So in application, these are just some example, but most of the organization nowadays uses the machine learning and deep learning models. So but these are some famous, for example, healthcare. So we can train the model that on a symptoms, like given a symptoms and the disease name, that these are the symptoms, this is the disease, and these are the symptoms of that disease. So given a disease, symptoms of the disease, we train the model and it learns, and then after it learns, we can create an application, on online application, that only asks the user for the symptoms, that he has some swelling on his hand, or pain in his throat or something, and based on the symptoms, it tries to find out that what disease the user might have. So, and the some solutions for that disease. So we can create those type of system, and not only these, but even doctors uses the laboratories uses uses this machine learning approach to train X-rays and MRIs on it and find out the infected area in that X-ray or MRI. Then the sentiment analysis. So given an example of election. So it is one sentiment. It is one use case for sentiment analysis. It tries to understand the sentiments of the user. Then product reviews. So all the e-commerce site has a feedback system, and we most of the customers review the products, and based on the review, they actually analyze that which product is being sold mostly and which product is famous, so that they can give more offers on it and etc. And then fraud detection. So we all know that Gmail automatically segregate spam and not spam mails. So how it does that? So they have their own spam detector, means the system that divides these mails into spam and not spam. And you can report it. So if some email is spam and it is not scanned as an spam, then you can report it, and that report goes to the Google, and they add that into their database. And next, in the next run of machine learning model, it learns that, and the next time if you get those mail, it will automatically goes to spam. And e-commerce sites uses recommendation systems for recommending the products and everything. So these were the examples, but I want to show you one particular use case which is being used in real life. So it is an Uber. So all we know that whenever we book an Uber cab, then every time, even if it is the same place, the prices are different. So how they are calculating the price of how they are calculating the cost? So based on demand and number of cars available in that area, and what is the weather, it is raining outside or not. If it is raining, then the prices will go twice from the usual. So these are the, and in rush hour, even rush hours, like in morning time, the prices will be high, and in afternoon or even in evening, the prices will be low. But even as the sun goes down, and as the sun goes down, the price will go again high. So all this calculation is being done by these machine learning models. So a demo. So here this is a demo, but I want to show you my own code. So let me share you my screen. So can you see my screen?
Yes, Rubesh.
Yeah. So it is just a simple linear regression. So these are the x which I have given, and here the function is 3x plus 5. So this is the function 3x plus 5. I'm given an x, I'm calculating y, but I'm adding some random error here. So we know that not every system, every data that we get is accurate. So for that we are just adding some error. So I have just added error with 2. So it will add the error into that when it calculates the y. And I have just plotted it. So it is 0 to 15, so it will not look much of a different because the error is very low. But I can increase it, but you can see some variation if you really look closely. So this is the my x and y. I just called the function. So linear regression is the model, and these models, most of the models are available with some libraries. So sklearn, there's a stat model library, and then TensorFlow Keras. They have the pre-built functions. You just have to call the function and it will create the model for you. So this is just a processing. It is an array which is in raw format, I just have to convert it into columns. So means three, so it's like 3 and 14 in first column, second column 14, 48, just like that. So I just did it here, and then I created a model and then fit the model, fitted it here, and after fitting the model I just predicted the values for the given x, and I have predicted it and I just plotted it. So here the dots are showing the actual points, and the line shows the predicted ones. So it has learned that it is a straight line. If it is some other line, other curve, if it is like a sine curve, then even I can do that using a polynomial regression. And for different types of data, and so before going into choosing the model, we have to plot the data and see that what type of data, what patterns is there in the data, and based on that data patterns, we have to choose the model. So I just fitted the model, and after fitting the model, I'm just predicting for 90. So for this equation, if I give the x as a 19, then the y should be 62. And here this is my model which has learned this equation, function, and I'm predicting for 19, and it is giving me 62.57, which is nearly 19, which is nearly 62. So this .57 is there because of the error which I have added here. If I'll not add here the error here, then it will give me the exact 62 answer. But we know that in every system there is an error. So for that I just added the error, and it is okay if the prediction goes up and down, but a little bit. But if it is giving the wrong accuracy, then it is wrong. Then you have to choose something else, or maybe tune the model. I hope you can see my screen. Yeah. So next we comes to the deep learning. So as I said, the deep learning is a part of machine learning, a sub field of machine learning, and here the idea is to create a structure like a brain. The structure of the network or a model, like as it is such as that it is, it's act like a brain. And as we if you search online, then you will got to know that in our brain 86 billion neurons are there, and every neuron is connected to each other, and every neuron is intended to do some specific task. So for example, if whatever I am seeing right now, all the visuals are being understood and processed by some particular part of the brain and particular part of the particular amount of neurons. If I am hearing something, then the part of brain which process that audio is different than the one who process the eyes. So here is the idea, is to create the network like which behaves like a brain. And before I'm make you actually explain how it works, I just want to show you why we use deep learning. So as the performance goes, as the amount of data goes high, the performance of machine learning is not decreases, but it gets stuck somewhere. Means after some point, the accuracy will not go higher, the performance will not increase. So at that time, to increase the accuracy and performance of the model, we use the deep learning. So one more reason why we use deep learning, because if there are so many features, so many columns are there in data, then doing the feature engineering and understanding which feature to keep and which to discard is hard. Instead, the deep learning automatically does that. It automatically calculates the importance of feature, means the importance of that column. So feature, we call the column a feature in a data scientist language. So it automatically learns that, and it is also being used mostly because nowadays most of the data is unstructured, and deep learning is very good, and it is very impressive. It gives a very impressive accuracy for unstructured data, for like images and videos and audios and text, obviously text. So for the image classification, natural language processing, speech recognition, and this kind of use cases, we use deep learning. So what is neural network? Before that, just understand what is neuron. So neuron is something, is one unit which calculates some output and applies some activation on it. So here activation is here WX plus B. So it is same like MX plus B. Here M is replaced with W and C is replaced with B, because here W is called as a weight and B is calculated is called as a bias, and the neuron calculates it and apply activation on it. So why activation? So as I said that we do not have any feature extraction thing as such in neural network. Why? Because it has the activation. So what does activation do is that there is a functions, predefined activation functions are there. There are many softmax, sigmoid. So that functions actually calculates the means after calculating the this output, we give this output to activation, and based on the importance. So even it, the neuron, the network learns that how much important that column has. So importance, it is being learned while the training, and after the training it learns that whether the output of this is how much importance it has, and based on it, it provides the output to the next layer to the next neuron, we can say. So here is the neuron which we have in our brain, and here is the we use in neural network, artificial neural network, and it is kind of same. So here these dendrites. So these let me use laser. So these what you are seeing takes the input, and this is a part where the actually calculation is being, the process of that processing on that data is being done, and this is where the output is being given to next neuron. So more than one neuron combinedly creates a layer, and more than one layer combinedly creates a deep neural network. So yeah, this is the simple neural network with one hidden layer, and this is in the other hand it's a neural network with more than one layer, hidden layers, and which is called as deep neural network. So here the blue box which is input layer, which is X and Y, and output layer is the output, and all the calculation is being done in the middle, and how actually it is being trained. So there is a whole theory on it, means there's, if we talk about deep learning, then even one more hour will be passed, and mostly you will probably learn 50 or 60% of it, because here the actually as I shown here the WX plus B and sigma. So all these neuron has WT, different WT and B. So here on one first WT or B is different, and in other in the same layer is different. In the next layer also there is a different values for that. And when we train the model, our main intention is to find out that W and B value and active B value, so that it performs the output, it gives the output and perfectly. So some examples of the deep learning. So there are many. So even if most of us have used Google Translate. So have you ever thought that how Google is translating the text into some other language? So it is deep learning which is being used there for Google Photos, which segregates the photos by faces in our Google Photos application. It is also a deep learning algorithm. In Google Translate, it uses the natural language processing (RNN), and in second, it uses CNN, convolutional network, and then Facebook automated tagging. So when you actually upload the photo on Facebook, it automatically tags the people from your friend. So it is also being done using deep learning. And then OpenAI. So there are also some of the examples here. So this is a site which is this person does not exist. So every photo which you see here is not a person. It is the image that is being generated by a computer with the deep learning and the generative adversarial network GAN model, and this project is built by NVIDIA. So each person here is not a real person. It is being created. This image is being created by a model, by a deep learning model. So one more, it is one open AI 5. This is a project of OpenAI is a company owned by Elon Musk, and this is a project where they've created a multi player agents for Dota games, and those agents are so accurate that it has the best players of the world, of all over the world, best players of the all over the world also gets the also had the hard time playing against the these agents. And you can read this OpenAI blog. Here they mentioned how many CPUs they've used, how they've created actual all these. And then this is the one more multi-agent interaction use case they've created, where the agents try to learn how to play hide and seek. So here the red agents are finding the person, and blue are the one who is hiding. So it is actually with the every iteration it learns to how to beat the other team. And you can find so many use cases like this on OpenAI, and not only OpenAI. There are so many companies are there who is working on the same. And now the source and references. So this is the links for you to refer. Means you can refer if you want to learn and come to this field. Then these are the some of the links. So Khan Academy statistic probability. So this is for build your statistics knowledge, and then machine learning Coursera. These courses are free, and these Udemy course I put it into optional because it is paid, but it is also good. But I don't recommend you to go through pay and learn from that, because there are other sites like Machine Learning Masteries, Tuvar Data Science, Analytics Vidya. These are the sites where actual data science developers put their blogs and their work, so that you can refer their work and learn from there. The Kaggle is the huge platform from where you can find the data, and TensorFlow and Keras for deep learning. But don't go for it right directly into it. Before that, complete with your basics. Do your understand the basics. These are the books. A few of the books. Hadoop Definitive Guide is for the big data those who interested in Hadoop and big data, and the machine learning guides and hands-on machine learning these are the books and question answers if anyone has any.
Thank you, Dhruvesh. I can see one question, that are there any prerequisite to learn data science?
Not actually, but you must have some knowledge about linear algebra, calculus, then Python basics, Python how to code in Python. Not the expertise, but that you should have expertise in that language, but you should know how to use these and those libraries that I showed in why Python and R. So there I have put some libraries name. So how to use those libraries, because we mostly use those only for in data science.
Okay, thank you, Dhruvesh. Thank you for sharing your insights, and congratulations. From tomorrow you are going to join the Blue Conch.
Yes.
So congratulations for that. And dear attendees, thank you for attending the webinar, and we hope that you found the webinar very informative and worthwhile. I can also see lots of alumni. I know that they are from the different time zone, but still they have managed to attend the webinar. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
Dhruvesh,
thank you everyone for
please accept our sincere appreciation. for the outstanding presentation. This is from all of us, from all the faculties of School of IT Aarou University.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.